Bueno, y como les prometí, estoy aquí con los creadores de Seis Manos, Brad, Al, and Dan. Or should I say Brad, Alvaro.
Alvaro.
And Daniel, right?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Why don't you call it like Al and then Dan?
If I get angry at how you say my name, I'll just stare at you really intensely.
Like a mom, Daniel!
Yeah.
How's everything?
It's good.
How did you guys meet each other?
I met Al, who was in Austin at the time, through the composer on Seis Manos, Carl Thiel, who had worked on a lot of the Rodriguez stuff that Troublemaker does. Al had written Machete and all of these other films, and so that's how we initially met.
And Daniel and I had met through the Writers Guild, a panel that Daniel was moderating that I was on Latinos and Horror. And so that's how we kind of all connected.
One question, do you consider Seis Manos an anime?
Oh, that's a good question. I think, I don't know, I grew up on anime when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. Actually, specifically, the first anime I ever saw was Ninja Scroll.
That's your favorite show?
Ninja Scroll was the first anime feature film that I ever saw. I mean, my friends had showed me Dragon Ball, and I got into it a little bit, but like Ninja Scroll was like the first thing that sort of blew my mind and got me, just went down a rabbit hole. I think I saw Perfect Blue next. And then Ghost in the Shell was like, that Ghost in the Shell, the movie, is still like my favorite thing. It's my favorite feature. Full Metal is my favorite TV show, but like Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood specifically. But like the thing that I connected to in all of that, and I've been writing TV animation for like 8-9 years now, was like in watching all that anime, was like the quality of the storytelling and the fact that you could do adult stories in animation, which is something that in the United States just didn't exist. Like, you know, most of the shows that I've written on prior to this have been like shows that are like demographic like 8 to 11 year olds, because that's the type of animation that exists here. It's like, you know, Disney, Nickelodeon, stuff like that, which is great. But like, there is this whole world where you can do other stuff with animation, right? And so when I saw that, I was just like, it was like the fox and the grapes. I just wanted it, right? And so I've been going around for years pitching like my own version of like an adult animated show. And when I found out about the Brad and Alvaro like building the Seis Manos world, I was just so grateful to be able to get to be involved, because that's the thing that I attached to. It was like, oh my god, this is a chance to tell an adult story with animation and like with like limbs flying and like interesting like philosophical questions being asked. And it was. That's the excitement that I grabbed to. So, like, I don't know whether the question of, like, anime or not anime, I think it more like, oh, good, finally, there are all these places in the world now where we can finally do this amazing thing that Japan figured out a long time ago, which is you can tell any kind of story with animation.
I think it's like music, right? Like, like a fusion of genres that you put, like, using elements from some type of shows or whatever you want.
Like, and part of the role that I think we played with developing this is like we're like the DJs. Yeah. This is a remix. This is an anime remix. You know, it's a remix too. You know, because there's this.
<that's>, remix. Boom. Hashtag
remix. I mean, because that's, you know, in my mind, I always, when we first conceived of this thing, I said this is a Mexic anime. You know, this is at least a Texic anime. Yeah. You know, there's all. That's I think the beauty of the art form is that it becomes. It becomes anybody's to develop and take and, you know, use what you can use and bring something new to the table with it and all of that stuff.
Yeah, totally.
And so, yeah, we've definitely had these influences. I mean, for me, it was seeing Akira. I saw Akira 3 times in a theater when it first came out. And, you know, it was a thing that blew my mind. But, you know, I also grew up watching, like, the heavy metal movie and, you know, movies like Fantastic Planet and stuff like that. And so, you know, it wasn't to me so much that you couldn't tell these stories in an adult space. There were some of those things, but they were harder to find. You know, you had to really go and hunt for these things. There was a TV show when I was a kid called Night Flight, where you would see things like this, where otherwise they were just impossible to find. And now the idea of like making this accessible to a greater audience, that's one of the great sort of democratizing things about Netflix and about anime too. You know, it's like, we're telling global stories. That's, you know, Netflix's idea. This is a global stories for, you know, a new anime. And so, yeah, I think that's definitely what we're trying to do.
The show is definitely anime influenced, but, you know, between our shows, Castlevania and Seis Manos, even those two are so radically different from each other. At the end of the day, you make animation to serve the story. Like, you pick his design, you animate it, you do the action in a way that serves what the story is. And so even though it might have these influences from all different kinds of media, it's, you don't really kind of put it into a box and say, we're going to make an anime show, we're going to make Seis Manos.
I think nowadays there's no rules.
Right.
Like, for anything. Yeah. Like, you do what you want and that's it.
You do what you want, because you find that, you know, someone somewhere will dig it. You know, someone somewhere will like it and love it and want more of it.
Yeah, I do. Actually, this show is going to be, like, really important to the Hispanic community. What inspired you to do, focus in the Latin community and not in another community?
Well, I grew up on the border between Texas and Mexico, down in the southern tip of Texas in the Rio Grande Valley.
So you speak Spanish.
So I spoke Spanish. I grew up, you know, with cousins who spoke only Spanish and cousins who spoke only English, and I was somewhere in between, you know. So
five words in Spanish now.
Five words in Spanish? Oh, God, let's admit.
Tu madre. Oh, I.
No!
You know five words then?
Well, I mean, I'm half Mexican.
¿Entiendes, Mendes, o te explico Federico? How about that?
Oh, but no, there's no Federico here, but. Let's have said that. Okay, how was the process in choosing, like, the boss voice actors in the show? How was the process? This is a guy to do Silencio. By the way, I think the names are amazing. Like, okay. Silencio, like, what?
Yeah. No, like, I mean...
Silencio.
Silencio, absolutely. You know, it was amazing working with the voice actors, Angelica Valle and Aislinn Derbez and Mike Coulter and Johnny Cruz, Danny Trejo, Raul Castillo, all these other actors that we worked with, you know, they all brought something different to the project that, you know, it's like, as a writer, you learn how to, like, leave something for the actor, and these guys just, like, made it a revelation because they inhabited their characters so well. You know, Aislinn brought so much life to Isabella, Johnny brought so much joy to his character of Jesus, Danny Trejo brought so much, you know, power to the character of Alvaro, and you know, so they were all incredible to work with.
Yeah,
awesome.
And at the end of the day, you know, we work with a casting director, and they send a whole bunch of different actors and takes. Meredith Lane was the casting director on this show, and what you try to do, at least what I try to do, is I, you know, look at the character design and then just kind of shut the eyes and try to picture that voice with that character. And what do they bring? What do they add to it to make it bigger and better? And then once you narrow it down that way, you try to find the best person.
Great. Okay, this is a personal question.
Okay.
Do it.
Who came up with the name Cerdos for the police?
Cerdos,
yeah. I knew it.
Cerdo?
Cerdo. I mean, like...
If there are any cops who are watching this, it was Alvaro. anyone else was me.
Do you think, like, people are starting to call the police, like, Cerdos?
Well, because, you know, it's the old thing of, like, the pigs, right? And so that's where it came from.
I mean, the pig is the second most, like, the most intelligent animal, the second one. It's not, like, something bad.
It's a compliment, ultimately, right? It's a compliment.
That's what we meant.
Yeah.
Also, it's one of the tastiest animals, too.
Yeah.
Which, I don't know, that's actually a creepy thing to say. I don't want to eat the police.
So if you're a vegan, chill. It's a joke.
Yeah. Okay. There's also mangoes in the show, so...
Lots of mangoes.
Yeah.
And lots of mangoes. There's a lot of mangoes in my country, too.
Yeah.
look, one question. In the second episode, the song is amazing. I just heard it, and it's amazing. Like, did you look for it, or did you get that song, or how was
that?
So,
this is a song that I've known probably for, I don't know, 20, 30 years. It was originally recorded by this woman, Lydia Mendoza. She claimed to have found the lyrics, I believe, on the back of a bubblegum wrapper back in the 1920s or 30s.
What?
And then she wrote the music for it. It was just a song that, you know, came to my mind as we were writing and conceiving of this thing of wanting to do a scene that was set with a musical element like this. And so working with Carl Thiel and Vanessa Del Fierro, who sings the song, you know, Carl just created this, like, amazing song that goes from a kind of quiet acoustic thing into this huge orchestral thing that is a part of a very violent fight sequence and in the show. And it just was like that perfect, you know, marriage of you know, beauty and craziness.
And not knowing all of the history from it and coming to it secondary after Al had, you know, put it inside of the episode, It was, you know, I heard the original version. I was like, what is he thinking? Yeah. Like, what is this going to be like? And then Carl slowed it down and transformed it. And initially we boarded that whole scene to Carl singing the song. He just kind of he played it on guitar and sang it by himself. And then we're like, yeah, this is really, really cool. And then we got the recording with Vanessa singing on it. And we're like, oh my God, this is just, and it's so, there's such a contrast between the song and the animation that really fits the whole tone of the show, in my opinion. I don't know. I think
it's a perfect fit.
I love, honestly, there's this moment in it for me when I was watching it where, like, because it starts out so beautiful and sad, and you're like, your heart is like swelling, and you're just like, oh, and I'm connecting to it emotionally, and then like a head gets knocked off, and you're just like, oh! And it's such a great like transition, like emotional, like, whoa, what's happening now? Yeah.
It's my favorite, when we were working on the show, it was my favorite thing to show people when they came into the office. They're like, what is this about? And I would just show that clip and not explain anything.
That's great.
Just let that set the tone.
I'm pretty sure that you wrote like all the comedy stuff, right?
No, honestly, no. And it's actually fun too, because like, yeah, like I've written a lot of comedy television, and Alvaro has written a lot of like dramatic and action feature and television. Mm-hmm. And so coming into that space, you know, and Brad will talk about this too. He'll be like, he tries to figure out what Al and I wrote, and we'll never tell him. But the amount of like goofy jokes that Alvaro injects into this thing is so
funny. Daniel is very funny because he's done all these things. I'm kind of funny in real life. And so together we kind
you
of
have
like,
a balance.
We have the balance, yeah.
Yeah,
and I'm funny on the inside.
I'm tragically unhappy.
Funny on the inside. Yeah.
I'm deadly serious in real life. Yeah, I just stand there looking very morose, and I just put a hand on Alvaro, and I try not to cry.
Yeah.
And then Alvaro is very sweet, and he makes me feel better.
It's true. Yeah. I mean, that usually happens to comics.
Yeah, no, all comics are sad clowns.
Yeah.
All of them are just like, please,
like
please save me.
And, yeah, and inside they're like that inside.
Yeah.
I mean, in the comedy way.
No, if you, honestly, to say, if you want to save a life, if you go see stand-up comedy, when you see them walking off stage, just hug them and whisper, you're going to be okay. And they'll feel better.
Yeah. Okay, so we are in the Comic-Con week. We're actually here. And what is the creepiest thing that happened to you here? Like, I'm pretty sure.
Are you trying to get us like trolled online? What kind of questions?
I mean, something happened to you, like something creepy, I'm pretty
creepy?
Sure.
Creepy? My favorite thing was, you know, I don't know how familiar, so in Street Fighter 2, there's a character called Zangief, and my favorite costume I've seen so far is the Zangief costume, because it's basically just an excuse for a dude to walk around in a thong.
Oh yeah,
that was pretty cool.
Yeah. I didn't know that was cosplay, I figured that was just kink.
Yeah. What's the weird? I'm trying to think of more.
Yeah, I don't know. But we just got here, so I'm sure there'll be plenty more opportunities to be freaked out.
Yeah.
I saw, actually, you know, one thing was, I forget who it was, we were walking around and someone goes, hey, Doc Brown from Back to the Future. And it was just a woman who had white hair and had a yellow jacket on.
Yeah. Or you were telling me something, like, in a bit, in an elevator, was it? Like, he was talking with a SpongeBob thing?
Oh,
like
you wrote for
SpongeBob.
No, that was actually really funny. So, like, I wrote for SpongeBob SquarePants, and I saw there was, like, a really sweet concierge guy or whatever who was, like, he was wearing a SpongeBob shirt, and I was like, oh, I wrote for that show. And then he, like, leans in really close and is just like, anything you need, man, I got it. And I was like, oh, okay, cool.
You said that? Yeah, like, there you go.
I asked for a Tesla.
Tesla? Oh, the big one on the...
He was out. He was out of Teslas.
Oh, so what are the future plans for this, for Seis Manos? Do you have any, like, toys or anything?
There's discussion about all kinds of things. You know, like, as far as future plans, I'm just hoping that, you know, the show will find its audience. People will love it. People will dig it. And,
yeah, y'all want fun,
you know,
here.
We'll have more seasons. And, you know, I feel like this is a world we're just beginning to explore. And so, you know, future plans, I hope we get to do a lot more.
Should we expect something in the, I mean, I just saw the first two, in the other episodes, it's something like, no spoilers, but
yeah.
Is there something?
I hope so. I mean,
should like definitely see.
Oh yeah. I think that if the whole goal of the show, right? We wanted this show to be the kind of thing where an episode ends and you press the button to start the next episode before the clock tells you it's going to go into the next episode.
Right.
It's a real bingeable quality to the show, I think, too. So yeah, there's all kinds of, I think, surprises and twists in the story that people are going to, you know, people will like, people
yeah.
will enjoy.
And for fans of all the 70s genre stuff, there are lots of little Easter eggs and tributes to specific films and specific Mexican cinema and, you know, all of that sort of stuff. So
yep.
there's a lot to pay attention to.
There's some great horror Easter eggs. And like, yeah, when you originally conceived it, we conceived like a three season long story for the whole, like all of the characters to go through and experience. So if you love the show, just keep watching it over and over again so we get three seasons at least.
Yeah. Yes, I am.
And then, you know, if we get more than three seasons, and I don't know, they'll just characters will just start going on vacation and having wacky adventures and getting into fights in like Hawaii or whatever. Great.
So if you guys have to choose one episode, just one episode, what's that episode?
Wow.
Like your favorite. Like, this is the episode that...
Well, since they wrote, you know, the different episodes, I feel like it would be kind of like not cool to just be like, well, this is specifically my favorite episode. But
I'll say my favorite episode.
Okay.
To me, the final episode just kind of ties all of their stories together yeah. in a way that nobody will see coming. And so to me, watching all of that culminate in the last episode, and it's just jam-packed with action, that's my favorite episode.
I mean, I can think of at least three things in the first season that absolutely no one will see coming, and I won't even say what episodes they're coming in, but like, I think there's a tie for me between the seventh episode and the fourth episode of this season. The seventh episode is just, it's just so good. I don't even know, it's just so fun and interesting. There's so much, like all the stuff, like all the kung fu, all the horror, the comedy, just it's really comes out in that episode. And then the fourth episode I really love just because, again, I'm a horror nerd, and there's like some really, really great horror Easter eggs in that episode.
Yeah, I agree. I'm kind of in that same boat with Daniel. 4 and 7, I think, really are great examples of what the show is. You know, there's a feeling for me now, I don't even think about it in terms of episodes because it feels
yeah.
like such a complete thing. And it goes by so quickly and you just want more and more and more. So, you know, I just think like... the first season is my favorite episode.
Oh no, also the second episode because I got to do my darkest character idea.
Oh.
And then I'm just going to find a thing that's my favorite thing about every episode so I don't sound like I'm playing favorites. Let's see. No, it's episode 6. It's great because of how good it is.
6. So now
6 is a good one.
2, 4, 6, and 7.
And yeah. then 1 is really great too, and 3 and
5
8 are
strong.
Also,
7.
It I is, like 5 a lot.
It is the fastest paced thing that I've ever worked on, and so it really is kind of like a roller coaster ride. Like once it picks up and you get to the end of the first episode and then it drops and then it just...
There's a lot of emotion to it.
Yeah, there's a lot of emotion to it.
Yeah, we really got to like... That's another thing that I always really loved, why I connected to anime when I was a kid, is like in this show we got to like... The sad is really sad, you know? The funny is really funny. The action is very intense. Like the stuff that's like in angry, it's like it makes you infuriated. Like yeah. the horror is scary. Like it's, you know, you'll go through the roller coaster for emotions yeah. there. So
I almost cried when the
yeah. Spoiler alert.
My point is, you know, yeah. after watching the show, you'll
you
go
really
through
know?
Such an emotional.
No, load. Yeah. It was like oh.
Yeah.
I like them.
That's good.
We'll be back.
So, okay, last question. Any of you fight or nothing? Any of you, like, know how to fight?
When I was 13, I accidentally kicked a tumbleweed into the second most unpopular kid at school's face, and I was the most unpopular kid in school. And then everyone started shouting, fight. And so I walked up to him, and I swung, and I missed by, like, a foot. And then he hit my nose, and then everyone said he won the fight.
Yeah.
That's my only fight.
I mean, now you fight in Seis Manos. writing.
I write fighting.
Yeah.
But Brad does kung fu.
I've done kung fu for about 18 years.
You know your shit.
I try. I do my best.
Awesome.
When I first met Brad, and he was telling me about how he does legit kung fu, which I have not seen you do a fight, so I need
to see. I can't show you the kung fu the style, yeah. And then you would have an advantage. Like, you don't show people kung fu, you just
fight.
I'm gonna try to sell this as concisely as possible. When we first met Brad, he's like, I'm into kung fu and stuff. And he's like deep cut kung fu, and he's like, yeah, I have a thing in my garage that is full of steel pellets, and I go in there at night and I hit it 100 times, so I have one hard hand and one soft hand. And I looked at him and I was like, how does your wife feel about that? And she was like, she's not a huge fan of it.
That's true. Okay, cool. Thank you for being on this channel. It was a pleasure to have you guys know a little bit better of Seis Manos. I'm pretty sure that it's going to be super successful. So
you know what else is successful?
Huh?
That shirt. That is a fantastic shirt, sir.
Yeah. It's very SpongeBob.
Yeah, I like the pineapples. Making me hungry.
I know how to do some voice for SpongeBob. You should hire me.
Oh, yeah?
Hey, SpongeBob.
Patrick. You got it. We'll talk after.